Well, I want to say good morning to you again, or good afternoon, or evening, whatever the time may be, whenever you are watching this. But truly, thank you for joining us again as we worship our great God together. In the message at the end of this, you're going to hear a little bit about some spiritual disciplines, spiritual practices that we can be doing together as a family. So here at the outset, I just want to draw your attention to those digital bulletins that Tammy sent out. Maybe they were mailed to you directly by paper, but either way, just to draw your attention to those bulletins, at the bottom you'll see the our usual sermon discussion questions. As usual, you know, we want to encourage people to be talking through those, but recognizing that most of our Sunday school classes and small groups have greatly altered or reduced opportunities to process together, we really want to encourage you as a family, after this is over, around the table, maybe around a meal, or there in your living room, talk through these together, and let's process how the Lord is speaking to us through these messages. Like last week, we are going to have some songs mixed in, also a video as well, for your encouragement and comfort. Pastor Casey will lead us in a congregational prayer, and so let's pause here at the outset, and remember that wherever you are, we are in the presence of our Heavenly Father. The church is not a building. He dwells inside those who have been made new by His Son, by His Holy Spirit. And so we are in the presence of the Father, and we say with the psalmist, let us exalt the name of the Lord together. Father, we pray that Your name would become more greatly magnified and worshiped all over this earth. The greatest tragedy is that men and women do not know You. So we pray that through this time, Your word, and through this body of believers, that You would magnify Your name on earth as it is in heaven. And let's continue to praise Him as we sing to our great God together.
Yeah. Psalm 23.
Il Divino Pastore, Salmo di Davide.
O Senhor é o meu pastor e nada me faltará.
The Lord is my shepherd. I have all that I need.
El Señor es mi pastor.
The Herr ist mein Hirte.
The Lord is my shepherd. I have all that I need.
Nada me faltará.
I have all that I need.
Il Signore è mio pastore, nulla mi manca.
The Lord is my shepherd. I have all that I need.
The Lord is my shepherd.
I have all that I need.
The Lord is my shepherd. I have all that I need.
The Lord is my shepherd.
The Lord is my shepherd. I have all that I need.
I have all that I need.
He leads me beside peaceful streams.
I have all that I need.
He leads me beside peaceful streams.
I have all that I need.
He lets me rest in green meadows.
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 He leads me beside peaceful streams.
He renews my strength.
He leads me beside peaceful streams.
He renews my strength.
I have all that I need.
He renews my strength.
He renews my strength.
Gibt mir Kraft.
He renews my strength. He refreshes my soul.
Und gibt mir Kraft für mich.
He guides me.
He guides me along right paths.
He guides me along right paths.
He guides me along right paths.
Bringing honor to his name.
Bringing honor to his name.
Bringing honor to his name.
Even when I walk through the darkest valley,
I will not be afraid.
Ainda que eu andasse pelo vale da sombra da morte.
Even when I walk through the darkest valley.
Even when I walk through the darkest valley.
Porque tú estás a mi lado.
I will not be afraid. I will not be afraid.
I will not be afraid.
Even when I walk through the darkest valley.
I will not be afraid.
I will not be afraid.
I will not be afraid. For you are close beside me.
And yea, though I walk through the valley of the shadow of death, I will fear no evil.
I will not be afraid.
I will not be afraid, for you are close beside me.
For you are close beside me.
For you are close beside me.
For you are with me.
I will not be afraid.
For you are close beside me.
For you are close beside me.
Your rod and your staff protect and comfort me.
For you are close beside me.
For you are close beside me.
For you are close beside me.
Your rod and your staff protect and comfort me.
Tu vara y tu cazado me protegen y confortan.
You prepare a feast for me in the presence of my enemies.
Your rod and your staff protect me and comfort me.
I will not be afraid.
For you are close beside me.
Your rod and your staff, they comfort me.
You prepare a feast for me in the presence of my enemies.
在我敵人面前, 你為我擺設筵席。
You prepare a feast for me
in the presence of my enemies.
I will not be afraid.
For you are close beside me.
Preparas uma mesa perante mim na presença dos meus inimigos.
You prepare a feast for me in the presence of my enemies.
You honor me by anointing my head with oil, my cup overfloweth.
My cup overflows with blessings.
My cup overflows with blessings.
My cup overflows with blessings.
I have all that I need.
My cup overflows with blessings.
My cup overflows with blessings.
My cup overflows with blessings.
Surely your goodness and unfailing love will pursue me
all the days of my life.
My cup overflows with blessing.
All the days of my life.
My cup overflows with blessings.
All the days of my life.
Todos los días de mi vida.
All the days of my life.
Sikuzotes a maisha yangu.
All the days of my life.
And I will live in the house of the Lord forever.
And I will live in the house of the Lord forever.
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 Para siempre.
Forever.
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 Forever. E io abiterò nella casa del Signore per lunghi giorni.
And I will live in the house of the Lord forever.
And I will live in the house of the Lord forever.
E abitarei na casa do Senhor por longos dias.
And I will live in the house of the Lord forever.
Surely your goodness and unfailing love will pursue me all the days of my life. And I will live in the house of the Lord forever.
Well, good morning. Well, this morning as we go into our time of prayer, that video as you just saw, I think it's extremely fitting. This morning as we remember, this is one of those unique times. It's not just something facing a state, a region, even one country, worldwide people, and that includes the church. There are Christian brothers and sisters that are struggling right along with us, whether that's in minor ways or in hot spots where there's much more uncertainty. So we want to not only remember that there is a brotherhood. This morning, we also think it's fitting that we remember our own missionary partnerships. Antrim, of course, has several. And if you're looking at the bulletin that's come out, list them by name and a few of their needs. So what a wonderful reminder that not only are people working there on the field, but at the same time, they're not only struggling and surviving, but they're still ministering. Ministry has not ended. That's a beautiful thing in all of this. So we want you to continue to pray for those people who are still juggling life, trying to minister to people, to protect their own health, many times throw a foreign culture on top of all of that. And we know some of them have some great burdens right now. So our prayers, I'm sure, are greatly appreciated. Just to name a few, we can't go through all those needs, but just to name a few, some missionaries that are particularly close to the Antrim Church family would be Bonnie and Steve Westbury with Priority One. As you may know, they have a ministry to people in the Bronx and areas of New York City, an area that no doubt has been just lamb-blasted, has had so much struggle, has so many COVID cases. I'm told there's a lot of needs for financially for the ministry, for the people there, as well as, I'm assuming, just heightened anxiety all across the board for the people they are trying to love. Kirsten Hallbaker would be another one as she teaches overseas. I know she's struggling with, teaching remotely to kids in a foreign culture. So learning a lot as she goes, and she has asked for our prayers. It'd be good to pitch one praise in there. Myrna Gowing did arrive home just a few days ago from Africa after a very crazy week of ups and downs, finding flights and getting flights canceled, but she is here safely resting. For that, we are very thankful and praising God. So one last thing before I pray, I would like to encourage all of us, and this isn't just for missionaries, but we all have a mission field. We're used to saying that, but every single one of us, we have friends, we have families that right now there's fear, there's anxiety. Some people very legitimate concerns financially. Maybe they work in a field that they're just afraid of contracting this horrible disease. The thing is, the gospel was made for this. That's never stopped. Christ, the hope he gives through his gospel, was tailor-made to find a home in such hearts. So whether we know him or whether it's someone we know who does not have the hope Christ offers, there's great potential here, and we're asking the Holy Spirit would work and use us in that way. So with that, let us pray. If you please bow your heads with me. Almighty God, again, Lord, what a pleasure to call upon you in your power, to remember that you have all glory and sovereignty. Lord, you who are not moved, we who anchor ourselves to you who are not moved in this storm, we give you praise. We continue to acknowledge, Lord, in our communities, in our nation, there's very real needs. You, Lord, of course, are a very real God, possessing all that's needed. Of course, Lord, you continue to often, Lord, not to explain to us your ways, but Lord, you tell us to sit, Lord, just to still ourselves before you, to trust you, to acknowledge that you are at work, that your love, your grace, and mercy, they are sufficient for us. So Lord, we continue to ask for the very real needs all across the board in our nation, across our world. And we do ask that you would be pleased, Lord, that your spirit would work perhaps now in ways that it often or normally would not, as hearts and minds are tilled, Lord. We know there is a mission field. We know there's a field of harvest. Just pray, Lord, that the reassurance that you bring, the promises that you bring, the strength and power that you promise to never neglect from your people, this will find a home in those that need it right now. Lord, whether it's believers, whether it's those that do not know you yet, Lord Jesus, Lord, we just pray for your spirit to work. And Lord, you may have possibilities for us to work, for those that we love that need this, that need you. So again, Lord, this morning we want to pray for workers far and wide. We just thank you, Lord, that the church continues. Regardless of what our physical meeting looks like, thank you, Lord, that the gospel of Jesus Christ will never be overcome. So go with us this week, Father. We, again, Lord, ask you to work in all the ways that we need, all the ways that we can't. But lift you up, Lord. Continue to praise your name as you make yourself known here. It's in Christ Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Treasure, thou art. Well, our passage today is Matthew chapter 6, verses 1 through 18. And again, we are doing the Sermon on the Mount in chunks. We are not doing everything. We're not doing everything in detail. You could certainly easily preach six different messages just on today's passage. And so we're not going to hit every nuance and every possible issue. I'm going for the big picture. Today's section, the giving of alms, charitable giving, giving of alms, prayer, and fasting. Today's section is very appropriate to do for at least two reasons. The first one is, these are spiritual disciplines that the church has traditionally focused on for Lent. Lent is the season of buildup and preparation for Easter. And so amidst everything else going on, Easter is still coming. We are still preparing for Easter spiritually, even if it looks a little bit different externally this year than maybe what we've become used to. But Lent is that season of joining Christ, taking up our cross and learning to live not for ourselves, but for those around us and to the glory of God. And so these are Lenten disciplines. It's very appropriate to cover at this time. The second reason why today's passage is very appropriate to cover today is because, as I mentioned last week, as we face increased isolation, increased time away from those around us normally, what better opportunity would you ever have to practice certain spiritual disciplines? Things like prayer. As we face increased societal needs, what better opportunity will you ever be given to practice giving? As we face increased shortages, what better time will we have to practice fasting, learning to do with less, to do without? It's a very relevant passage for today. So let's learn to do these things, and let's learn to do them the right way. This section is a continuation of what we looked at last week. And so that key verse from last time, chapter 5, verse 20, is still very much an umbrella covering everything we're going to hear today. Chapter 5, verse 20, Jesus says, "Unless your righteousness surpasses, far exceeds that of the Pharisees and the teachers of the law, you'll certainly not be saved. You'll not enter the kingdom of heaven." Now, in the second half of 5, what Jesus was doing was contrasting the teaching of the Pharisees. You have heard they were saying this, but I say to you that. He's contrasting the teaching. Today, we're going to see that he is contrasting what they were actually doing, the practices of the Pharisees themselves. And certainly the two go together, the teaching and the practicing, but there are the emphases as they are given to us. So last week, hearing on the Mount what was being taught, this week, today, doing on the Mount, the practices, what they were doing, and in contrast, what the true believer should be doing. So we're going to hear first what you're meant to do, what you're meant to do. We're talking about the religious life, spiritual practices, specifically today. The second half of chapter 6 is going to deal more with life in general, and we plan, Lord willing, to get to that next week. But today, the practices of personal piety, what you're meant to do. Second, we're going to hear the way you're meant to do it. Not just externals, just like last week, not just externals, but the right heart, the right motivation underneath it, the way you're meant to do these things. And then third, what'll get you to do it that way? Because I can tell you it's not going to happen naturally. It's not going to happen automatically. So we got to hear what'll give us the right heart. We got to hear the way that'll get us to do it the way we were meant to. So Matthew 6, 1 through 18, living on the Mount, doing on the Mount. Jesus continues, "Be careful not to do your acts of righteousness before men, to be seen by them. If you do, you will have no reward from your Father in heaven. So when you give to the needy, do not announce it with trumpets, as the hypocrites do, in the synagogues and on the streets, to be honored by men. I tell you the truth, they have received their reward in full. But when you give to the needy, do not let your left hand know what your right hand is doing, so that your giving may be in secret. Then your Father, who sees what is done in secret, will reward you. And when you pray, do not be like the hypocrites, for they love to pray standing in the synagogues and on the street corners to be seen by men. I tell you the truth, they have received their reward in full. But when you pray, go into your room, close the door, and pray to your Father who is unseen. Then your Father, who sees what is done in secret, will reward you. And when you pray, do not keep on babbling like pagans, for they think they will be heard because of their many words. Do not be like them, for your Father knows what you need before you ask him. This, then, is how you should pray. Our Father in heaven, hallowed be your name. Your kingdom come. Your will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread. Forgive us our debts as we also have forgiven our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For if you forgive men when they sin against you, your heavenly Father will also forgive you. But if you do not forgive men their sins, your Father will not forgive your sins. And when you fast, do not look somber as the hypocrites do. For they disfigure their faces to show men they are fasting. I tell you the truth, they have received their reward in full. But when you fast, put oil on your head and wash your face, so that it will not be obvious to men that you are fasting, but only to your Father who is unseen. And your Father, who sees what is done in secret, will reward you. This is the word of the Lord. First, what we are meant to do. Obviously, there are three main blocks here. When you give, when you pray, when you fast. It's been said that these three blocks encompass the totality of a man's religious life, his religious experience. They cover how we relate to others, giving. They cover how we relate to God himself, prayer. And they cover the way that we relate to and control one's own person. The totality of a man's spiritual life are all right here. And so just like the illustrations, the six illustrations Jesus gave last week, I don't believe he is meaning to say here are the six and only six, or now the three and only three external rules. And if you just do these, you'll be fine. So much as he is merely using these as representative examples to drive at the heart. But so let's look at what he says. Are we forced into less social contact than ever? Jesus is saying there are certain things that we should excel at, even and especially when no one else is around. I mean, even with social distancing, there are so many opportunities to serve others. Think about all the things we've been hearing and being encouraged to do. Checking in on friends, checking in on neighbors. A simple call or text messages, a simple gesture now might mean more than it ever did before. You can send cards to people. You can help out buying groceries for elderly or the immunocompromised, your neighbors. You can contact Pastor Casey if you want to help to get connected with the ministries of the church during this time. We're talking about opportunities to care for the sick if it gets to that point. Supporting local business. There are lots of opportunities to give selflessly to those around us. You could even start just right here. Take whoever it is that you're cooped up with right now. Are you ministering to them? Are you learning to live alongside them selflessly, to treat them as you would want to be treated? How are you doing just with that? Just start there. We all have a tendency to have all of our relationships point to ourselves. Jesus is calling us and showing us we are meant to reverse that direction and give with no thought to ourselves, but concern for those around us. Giving, even amidst social distancing. How about prayer? With those same family members, whoever you're cooped up with, are you growing in prayer over these last several weeks? Now, I know, don't object. Don't say to me, don't give me this objection. He says not to do it in front of any other people, so I shouldn't do it with them. I got to do it just by myself. Don't give me that objection. This is clearly an issue of the heart. We'll come back to this in a little bit. We're to do it not for the praise from men, certainly, but this is the very same sermon as chapter 5, verse 16. Let your light shine before men that they might see your good deeds and glorify your Father in heaven. He's talking about the motive. Right? Don't do it to earn praise from them, but yeah, do it with other people, even in front of other people, for community or for discipling. Jesus himself, he fasted 40 days and 40 nights in the wilderness before the sermon. He fasted 40 days it sure seems from the accounts like nobody was with him. And yet, he must have told somebody about it because the gospel writers know about it. They tell us about it. Right? So we do these things corporately and we instruct with them, but we always search our motives. Right? So don't resort just to that objection. How are we doing with praying with those around us? There is no question that family worship has become far too much a relic of the past. You think about it. He's saying, we're talking about reading the Bible together, worshiping together, praying together. We talk about relating to God, to others, and to ourselves. It's all wrapped up in one in family worship. It's all there. And how many of us have been saying for years, we don't have the time to do that, to sit down and read together and pray and worship together? Our schedules are just too busy. How many of us have been saying that for years? And now, more than ever, it's just not true. That's no longer the case. We have a real opportunity presented to us. How are we doing with it? Are you taking advantage of it? We have said, who has time for these things? And our social schedules have been cleared. I mean, I, for one, I don't have an excess of time, personally. I still have about the same amount of work to do. And now, on top of that, we're still trying to figure out how to respond to a pandemic organizationally. So in some ways, it feels like there's actually extra to do right now. But still, nevertheless, I mean, in spite of all of that, still, social activities and meetings have been canned. Are you praying more? Are we reading together, reading more? The plain truth is if we don't do it now, the plain truth can only be it's because we do not want to. Because all other excuses have been wiped away for us. You've got all the time there is right now. Family worship. If there's a Christian dad in the home, dad, it's on you. Take the lead. It doesn't have to be long. It doesn't have to be much. Read a few Proverbs. Great place to start. Chapter 10 and on. Just read a few Proverbs. Don't even read a whole chapter. Just read a few and then pick one and talk through what it would look like in a modern day scenario. Maybe read a psalm. Maybe pick a famous, well-known Old Testament story, a character that you know and love. Maybe read one episode of Jesus from the Gospels. The important thing is not that you read from all these different sections every single time. The important thing is that we read the Bible together every day, ideally early in the day. In my own family, we're a work in progress at this. But I can tell you that we read through Judges chapter 3 a few months ago, 2 months ago. Read through Judges 3. Othniel, Ehud, and Shamgar. I had the boys running around with these wooden rods yelling, "I'm Shamgar, I'm Shamgar." That was 2 months ago we read that. Last week we were getting ready for bed, and Graham took his shirt and he hiked it up over the top of his head from the back like a hood. And he looked up at me and sort of out of the blue he said, "Daddy, did Ehud wear a hood like this?" It's great. Just read. It'll stick with people. It'll stick with your kids. You don't have to hit it all. Just pick a few spots, and the more you go, you'll start to fill in the pieces. All right, so read together. Also, do music together. I know we're not all singers. That's okay. Here's where modern technology can really help us out. You have an Amazon account, a YouTube. You have access to YouTube, Spotify. I guarantee you your teenagers or grandkids have streaming platforms you and I have no idea about. Go to any one of those sites, any one of those apps, or have Alexa do it for you. Search for one of your favorite songs and press play. That's it. Maybe mouth a few of the words along with it. If you're comfortable singing, sing along. It doesn't have to be much. It doesn't have to be a cappella harmony or anything like that. But at the very, very least, you're thinking about the words together as a family. And the music is ushering us into an awareness of the presence of the glory of God. Just like the Psalms call us to use music to that end. Pray together. If your kids resent family worship, and here's where I came across a line recently that's been very helpful and challenging to me. Danielle and I are reading through a book called Parenting by Paul David Tripp. As I said, we're a work in progress in this. But Tripp points out, if you try to do family devotions and your kids resent it, they don't want to do it, it might be that there's a sin issue in their life, in their heart, causing them not to want to do that. That might be the case. Tripp says that it might also be the case that there's a sin issue in your life, in your heart, in mine, And that's why our kids don't want to do family devotions with us. You see, Tripp says it's very, very difficult to get down and yell in someone's face this close 1 minute, and then a little while later ask them to open up to you on very deep personal spiritual levels. You don't want to do it. And so if that's you, and as if your kids are resisting family devotions, and it's not their fault, but it's on us and what we've been doing as parents, if your kids are resisting, if that's you, if you find yourself there, what do? You start with this. You model what it looks like to receive the grace of God, to confess where you've been wrong, and to model what it's like to be changed by Him. And if you do that in front of your kids, family worship has already started. We have an opportunity that has been given to us. Activities canceled across the board. Jesus says in the first layer, He says, here is what you should do, most especially when no one else is around. How are we doing with it? Now, let me give us a picture. Let me tell us a story to keep us from just saying a few, God, would you let this coronavirus end as quickly as possible, prayers, and then pat ourselves on the back thinking we fulfilled what this passage is about. Let me tell you this story. A few years ago, a Western missionary was given the very rare privilege and opportunity to join one of the house church networks in China. A group of about 100 leaders or more from this very large house church network were meeting at an incredibly rural, secluded farm for a conference, for several days of training. It had to be tucked away in the middle of nowhere to avoid the attention of the security police. If the police had found out, all the participants would have been imprisoned or worse. So to keep it secret, they just all stayed in these little shanties, basically outdoor on this farm. And in the middle of that gathering, again, secret due to the very real threat of persecution out in the middle of nowhere in this rural farm. In the middle of that gathering, one of the days, during one of the sessions, the Western missionary was asked to share about the situation of Christians in other countries, in other parts of the world. And so because he had spent the majority of his years of service in the Middle East, he told what was happening in these Middle Eastern, predominantly Muslim countries. And he told about the very real persecution, the brutal honor killings for anyone who converted to Christianity or named the name of Christ, of Jesus. And he emphasized how God is at work even there and through all of these things. But just speaking of the situation, he had to be real and tell about the persecution. The session went late into the night. Finally, they decided to call it off, to take a break just to let everyone get a few hours of sleep before the next day. And so the Western missionary writes this. They called off late at night to take a break, and he writes, at 6 o'clock the next morning, I was awakened by screaming and shouting outside in the compound. My first thought naturally was that the security police had in fact come. They found us. But as my eyes adjusted to the daylight, I saw that there were no security police swarming into the compound. What I saw instead were those Chinese house church leaders and evangelists scattered around the farmyard, either lying or sitting on the ground, crying, screaming, and yelling hysterically, or so it seemed to me. Many of them were pulling their hair or clutching at their clothes. He said, I spotted my friend David, his one contact in the group who spoke English. I spotted my friend David across the way and I rushed over to him. I demanded to know what in the world was going on. He told me to be quiet and to listen. I said, I don't know a word of Chinese. You know that. What on earth do you mean? Listen. Again, he insisted, just be quiet, Nick. Before I could protest again, he took me by my arm and began to walk me among these people who were crying and screaming. Because I was now silent, I actually began to hear and to recognize the names of those two Muslim countries I just told them about the night before. The names of those two countries were being repeated again and again in passionate and anguished prayer. When David stopped and turned to look at me, there were tears streaming down his face. He said, they were so moved by what you shared last night about believers who were truly facing hardship, who were truly being persecuted, that they have vowed before God they will get up an hour earlier every morning to pray for those Muslim background believers that you told them about in those two countries until Jesus Christ is known throughout those two countries. In that instant, he said, I could see why the number of Chinese believers had gone from a few hundred thousand to perhaps hundreds of millions, all in the face of persecution. How's your prayer life been the last 2 weeks? How's mine? Are we praying more? We're not talking just more knee-jerk, shoot from the hip, God, would you end this and let me get back to work prayers. Not just, God, we're scared prayers. Not just, we need a little help with the economy or paying the bills prayers. Those have their place. But if that's all we increase, when this crisis goes away, so will they. So will those prayers. And we're not just talking length only, not just quantity of praying. We'll come back to a deeper reason for why a little later. But we're not even just talking, okay, I'm going to do an extra hour a day. Because if that's all it is, the second your schedule gets filled in again, that kind of praying will go away too. We're talking about connecting with the God of the universe as your Father. We're talking about getting to a place where we earnestly long for His glory to be made known above all things. Hallowed be Your name. Let people see it. Let it be realized on earth as it is in heaven. Repetition is not bad in and of itself, like those Chinese house church leaders were doing. It's an issue of whether it's mechanical or not. Whether it's manipulative or not, whether we think we will be heard on the basis of how many times we say it or for how long we say it. It's whether we're manipulating God versus an intense, sincere, simple God for your glory, this, whatever the prayer is. Jesus is talking about communing with God like that, about depending on Him. I am not sharing this today from the position of one who has mastered this or anything close to that. I'm not sharing this from the position of one who prays as richly as I want to. I am speaking from a position of conviction. Do you know how searching it is to preach through the Lord's own sermon? I'm preaching from a position of conviction myself, but I can tell you I've seen this firsthand myself as well. When I was in East Asia, there were three different main groups in our ministry in the city. There were Western missionaries, the Americans, there were the national believers, and there was another group of missionaries from South Korea. And the established missionaries, and of course the national believers, the established ones and the nationals, they spoke the language already. But the new missionaries, both from America and from South Korea, the new missionaries did not know the language. You know it's hard to do gospel work when you don't know the language yet? So there wasn't a lot of mission of evangelism that we could do right off the bat. So you know what the Americans did? We settled in. We got our apartment set up. We visited the stores and we tried to get familiar with, you know, some of the routines that we were going to have. We got settled. You know what the Koreans were doing that exact same time? What the Koreans were doing in that period before we started to know the language? The South Korean missionaries were getting up at 5 a.m. every day to prayer walk the campus in the city. Even now, receiving an email of Chinese believers right now who are thrilled that they have the opportunity to preach in public because everyone has to wear face masks so the facial recognition software can't recognize them when they stand on the street corners and preach. God have mercy. God forgive us if, and it's okay to rest and relax and unwind and all those sorts of things. We've been living at a frenetic pace as a society. There is an element of mercy in just getting us to slow down and remember what's important, who's important, both the people around us and the Lord. There's an element of mercy in that and getting us to rest. But may God forgive us if the number of TV shows and movies we are streaming far eclipses, if it far outpaces the comparable increase in our secret only before the Father, praying. May God forgive us, and may He give us grace to long for something better. So that's what we're supposed to do. Give to others. Live for the worship of God alone, and control, organize our lives in such a way that they would be to that end. That's what we're meant to do. Also, there's a certain way we're meant to do it. Two. Jesus says in verse 1, "Be careful not to do your acts of righteousness before men, to be seen by them. If you do, you will have no reward from your Father in heaven." It's the overarching principle for all three units. It applies to all three. We are to do them not for praise from men to ourselves, but for the glory of the Father in heaven alone. It overarches all three, and then it's affirmed with all three individually. Give your alms, say your prayers, do your fasting, not for the praise from men to yourself, but only to your Father. There is no reward from God for those who seek it from men. Those are the words of Martin Lloyd-Jones when he preached through this passage. If you do these things for the approval of those around you, you will get it. What a spiritual guy. What a great prayer life she has. You want to do it for the approval of those around you? You can get it. And that's all you'll get. And we have opportunity now, more than ever, to work on not just the things we are doing, but the underlying heart motivation for why we are doing them. To have our real heart motives exposed. No one else is around. Have your spiritual disciplines taken off or taken a hit? Has your spiritual life been maintained because it wasn't dependent on what others around you thought? Community matters. It's important. We're all learning that now more than ever. But we're talking right now about motivation. So have you been able to maintain your spiritual life, your disciplines, your practices of personal formation? Or have those things suffered because when you were doing them, really you were just doing them for the notice of others around you? I mean, personally, I'm wrestling with this. I finish this recording all three of these weeks. I finish this recording and I walk out and I think, I miss everybody. I miss them. And it's true, I do. I miss you. I wish you were here. I walk out every week and I say that, but I got to work through, do I miss them? Do I miss you for the real fellowship reasons? Or do I miss everybody because it's nice to have the 100 pats on the back? All the different comments of, that was really great, Pastor, even if it wasn't. What's my real motive? Who am I doing this for? We've got an opportunity right now to search out, to ferret our motives, to examine, and to change. Because you see, the thing of it is, if you hear stories like those Chinese house church leaders, if you hear a message like this challenging you to do more, to do better, if you hear stuff like this and you respond simply with, okay, I will, I'll do it, I'll muster up, I'll press through, I'll set the schedule, and I'll stick to it. If you do that, and your thoughts are all about proving you can do it or demonstrating you can, and not to the praise of God, then what's our real motivation? You're still doing it for the praise for yourself, not for praise to Him. The temptation of sin is so subtle here. You see other people drawing attention to their great prayer life, and you think, that's despicable. I don't do that. I would never be like that. You're being like that. You're becoming like that in that motive. It's your heart focused on what you are like, not on the glory of God. If all you do is you just set a new goal for more time in prayer, and you just decide, I'm gonna do it, so I must do it, that's self-reliance. It's not even prayer. You might as well not even do it. This is the first lesson from the Beatitudes, and you can't escape it. The whole way through the Sermon on the Mount, obeying begins with admitting you can't, and if you set out trying to on your own, you're tripping over the starting line. You're not even getting past the first line. The real issue is not pleasing men versus pleasing God. It's pleasing self versus pleasing God. Why do we want the praise from men? It's to make ourselves feel better. It's a matter of, are we praising ourselves or are we praising our Father in heaven? It's why he says we have to have ways to do our giving even while hiding it from ourselves. You can do things publicly and be okay at the heart level, and you can do things privately and not be okay. We got to examine what's going on the inside, not just what's going on the outside. If we just say, well, I'll go ahead and do it, You're compounding the problem. You're doing self-reliance, not worship to him. This is the problem with that whole scales of justice idea. You know what I'm talking about? The scales of justice. You say, or we think, and many, way more of us do this than we would actually admit, but we think we're going to take all the good a person does and all the bad a person does, and we're going to compare them, weigh them against one another, and if the good outweighs the bad, then I'll be all right. The problem with that is that not just does the bad outweigh the good, the problem is even what we think we're putting in on the good side is going in on the bad. We're doing it out of self-performance. Look what I can do. We're doing it out of self-glory, not honoring to God. It's not dependent on God. It's a bad deed. It's not, does the good outweigh the bad? It's that everything we do, everything we put in is bad. Isaiah 64, all our righteous acts are as filthy rags. A friend of mine sent me a devotional from Psalm 40 this week. You lifted me out of the miry pit and set my feet on the rock. And he made the comparison, and he's exactly right. The miry pit is like quicksand. And if you are up to your neck in quicksand, the only thing you can do is call out for help. Because any other movement you make, not just can you not get yourself out of it, but any movement you make is going to sink you deeper. It's going to get you more entwined, more caught up in the problem. We're up to our neck in this and beyond. You got to call out for help. It's the theme of the whole Sermon on the Mount. Repent, not try harder. Recognize I can't and ask for him on your behalf. We all know we're supposed to repent of our sins. We all know we're supposed to repent of our sins. But have you ever gotten to the point where you've repented of your righteousness? Where you've repented of your good deeds as well as your bad? There is no more searching passage of Scripture than this, than these sections of the Sermon on the Mount. The real definition of a Christian is not just someone who repents of their bad deeds. People in all kinds of religions do that. The real definition of a Christian is not just repent of bad, but we've also gotten to the point where we repent of our good, of our attempts to do what is right. It's the whole way through. The Beatitudes, here's what you're meant to be. You can never be this. You have heard that it was said, but I say to you, not just you got to live up to new externals, but you got to have a new heart to where these types of externals just flow out from within you. And now, chapter 6, not just here are a few good religious practices you got to do, but you and I have to get to a place where we do them out of single-minded, single-hearted devotion to the glory of God and nothing else. No praise, no attention to ourselves. We have to repent of our righteous deeds as well as our overt sins. In Pilgrim's Progress, there is a scene where Christian has a companion named Hopeful. And Hopeful is telling of his conversion experience and what brought him to faith. And it is 8 of the most powerful pages in the entire book. You see, Hopeful tells of the weight, the burden of conviction that was coming upon him. And he did not realize that all of this heavy conviction was actually the working and the wooing of the Holy Spirit. And so he resisted it at first and tried to get away from it. And Christian asks Hopeful if there was anything he could do that relieved all of this conviction. And Hopeful says, well, I couldn't turn back to my sins any longer because the conviction when I did them was now twice as bad. So he says, you know what I tried next? I tried to mend my life. I fled both my sins and sinful company as well. And I started to take to myself religious duties. Things like praying, reading, weeping for sin, speaking the truth to my neighbors, and so forth. And he says it worked for a while, but at last my conviction came tumbling upon me again, and it crashed upon me now in the face of all of my reforming, all of my personal reformation. And so Christian asked him, why were you so troubled if you had made all of these changes? And Hopeful replies at length. He says, the thing that troubled me now, even after all of my changes, is that if I look closely into the best of what I do now, I still see sin, new sin, mixing itself with the best of what I do, so that now I am forced to conclude that notwithstanding all of the favorable thoughts I used to have about these changes I was making and the good deeds I was doing, He says, now I realize that even if my former life had been absolutely faultless, he says, I have committed enough sin in one act of righteousness to send me to hell. I've committed enough bad in one good act to deserve nothing but hell. It's not good versus bad in your life. It's that everything you try to do good is bad because you're not doing it for him, you're doing it for you. You're doing it in a self-centered way, a self-directed way, a self-reliant way. You and I are not just meant to give and to pray and to fast. We're meant to do them with single-eyed conviction and devotion to the glory of God. Even if our starting point were neutral, even if that were possible, one good deed is enough to send us to hell. So what do you do? Have you ever gotten where you've repented of your righteousness as well as of your guilt, your sin? What do you do? It's impossible to the natural self. So how do you ever get to where you do not just the right things, but you do them the right way, and that is to the glory of God and nothing else? Three. What do you do? How do you do it? You know, Christian asked Hopeful the very same question. Not that Christian didn't know, but he asked him because nothing is more encouraging for believers who are facing situations that might cause us to be tempted to doubt and discouragement. Nothing is better than being reminded of what is true by a fellow believer. And so Christian asked Hopeful, so what did you do? You know what Hopeful's response was? He said, I realized I needed the righteousness of another man who had never sinned. And he said, I never would have seen that so long as I was satisfied with my own efforts. But now that I see their emptiness, my good deeds, I realize this is true. If all my righteous efforts come short, my only hope is the righteousness of another on my behalf applied to my account. This is the great theme of justification by faith. Justification by faith, it runs through the entire New Testament. It runs through all the Bible. And yes, it runs through the entirety of the Sermon on the Mount itself. Blessed are the poor in spirit, those who realize they don't have it on their own and they cry out in repentance and faith, and it's given to them. Justification by faith. Blessed are those who hunger and thirst for righteousness. You never hunger and thirst for something you already have. So to hunger and thirst is to realize you don't have it. You need it to be given to you to be filled with it from somebody else. Jesus introduces the whole message with repent, for the kingdom is at hand. Matthew chapter 4. And Jesus comes. He has come. And he perfectly did the will of the Father. He fasted. He prayed. And he gave mercifully his righteousness to those who were poor, who had no way of getting it on their own. He lived full of perfect praise heavenward, perfect control of his own person, and perfect selfless service to his fellow man. And when you admit your need of him, when you admit and see your own inadequacy and you believe on him, then justification by faith, his righteousness is given to you and your sin is put on him at that cross. Justification by faith. And you see, when you have this justification, it is a legal matter, yes, but it is not just a legal matter. When you have this justification by faith, there is also an actual change. You are not let the same. It's not just that you are reckoned as having done these things perfectly, even though you haven't. That is true. But it's also that. What'll get you to do things out of perfect love for the Father and for no other reason? What'll get you to do that? It's when you realize the weight of your sin and you stand before God and knowing you deserve nothing but hell. You stand before God and you see that he loved you so much. He was so filled with mercy toward you, with loving compassion for you, that he sent his only son to live without getting the praise from all those around him, to be rejected by them, to give his everything for you to the glory of the Father. When you really see that through the eyes of faith, I deserved hell and he gave me that. When you really see that, that is what will fill your heart with joy and your eyes with tears and your being, your whole being with new affections. You're seeing the beauty of Christ, and you're being made new. You're being given a new longing. When you see the beauty of Christ and what he did for you, that is what will give you such a heart for him that you say, I don't want any of these other things. I don't want this old self. I want you and you alone. You're being made new. You're getting to the point where you're going to start to do the things he's calling us to do here in Matthew 6. When you see in faith his love, you're being made new. And then and only then can you start to do what he's calling you to do. And it starts with recognizing you can't do it on your own. This is always the paradox in the Sermon on the Mount. You can never escape it. Martin Lloyd-Jones, when he preached on this, one of the other things he said was, we will never get rid of self by concentrating on self. The wrong way to do these things is to focus on self. He says, you'll never get rid of it by saying, okay, self, stop doing it, just do better. That's always going to be self-generated, self-motivated. The only way to do away with the old self is to be filled with, to be consumed by the far surpassing beauty and grandeur and glory of God himself and what he has done for you in his son, Jesus Christ. And so to that end, wherever you are, whoever you're with, would you join me in going before the Father in his son, Jesus Christ, and saying, in him, we long for you more than anything else. We long for you and ourselves and our church and for your glory to be made known all over this world. So would you join me in saying those things as we pray the Lord's Prayer together in closing? Let's pray. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be your name. Your kingdom come, your will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread. Forgive us our debts, as we also forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For yours is the kingdom power and the glory forever. Amen. As we sing this closing song, I invite you to contemplate how deep is the love of your Heavenly Father that he would do that for you, that he would send his Son. Jesus the Son did not come to convince the Father against his will. No, it was the Father's will that Jesus do all this for us. Where do you think Jesus got the idea? He's taken after his Father. Your Father loved you so much that he would do all this for you. And as we behold his love for us, let praise and worship for him alone bloom and blossom in these hearts. And I pray for some out there watching this today, perhaps repent and receive him in faith for the very first time. Why should I gain from his reward? I cannot give an answer. But this I know with all my heart, his wounds have paid my ransom. Let's sing to him together.
Face away as wounds which mar the chosen one.
Again, as Martin Lloyd-Jones said, there is no reward from God for those who seek it from men. We've been talking throughout this year about having clear spiritual vision, seeing 2020 spiritually. And a few times we have talked about how what will lead us to, what will help us see Him clearly is remembering that He sees us, even when no one else is around, even in the secret. And so this week, whatever you do, whoever you're with, whatever you get into, know that God is with you there and live for Him alone and know that He will reward us. And He sees all and one day will set all to rights. So go to God in secret first, then in service to others this week. And may God give us all grace to do so. Amen.